Hello, my friends. It has been about a month since I posted a YouTube video, and I've been working on quite a few cool projects that I'm very excited to share with you. So let's dive in. So the first one here is a very simple prototype that I built in Articulate Storyline, and it incorporates an AI-powered voice assistant. So this AI assistant can change things in the Storyline course, and you interact with it via voice. This has been out for a while now, but it's so much better now because the voice is so lifelike. So check it out. Again, this one is very basic. It's just for me to get the functionality working. And this AI assistant will change the background color of the slide based on its mood. So here we go. We'll have to give it mic access. Hey, how's it going?
Hey, it's going great. I'm feeling upbeat today.
Actually, sorry to interrupt, but you are the worst assistant ever. You are terrible at your job.
I'm sorry you feel that way. I want to help.
Just kidding. You're amazing. You make me so happy, and you are the best person in the entire world. Thank you so much.
Oh, thank you. That really means a lot. I'm so...
So there you have it, right? It sounds so lifelike. It's a real-time experience. This wasn't sped up or anything like that. So you can imagine the possibilities with this kind of technology incorporated into an e-learning course. It can automatically bring up resources for you. It can take notes for you. Again, I have this. Let me show you this other thing I'm working on. I'm trying to build a demo that is like a bit more engaging that I could share with the world. So I've been working on this like voice in the control room scenario where you, the learner, are tasked with collaborating with an AI assistant, and you both are responsible for like managing emergencies in this emergency control room. And then there are these different variables, like system health is the main game variable. Temperature might be rising or falling, pressure might be rising or falling. And there will be these different controls that you can either click or that the AI can click for you. So it's going to be like an interesting scenario where the AI is recommending solutions. They may or may not be the correct solution. So you could either take one of these actions yourself, or if the AI loses trust in you, it might start taking those actions. So kind of like a high stress scenario based thing where part of the learning goal is also, you know, not trusting AI 100% of the time, but using it as a helpful assistant. So if y'all have any ideas, let me know. Again, this is just like a test view right now. That I will build this out in Storyline with a nice user interface and nice controls. But that's just one of the prototypes I'm working on at the moment. The next one is the Instructional Design Project Lab. So I am so excited for this one. I'm not even exaggerating when I say I was like planning this course 4 years ago. I've worked with like over 10 instructional designers, directors, subject matter experts. Like so many people have been involved in bringing this course to life. We finally have the whole layout for the course. We know the deliverables that people need to build throughout it. And I'm re-recording it from scratch based on a whole bunch of feedback, right? We have like hundreds of survey responses that I've been going through to guide these updates. And I'm recording it from scratch myself. So these are all about to go live within the next couple of days. I have a lot more recording to do as well. We're incorporating emails from clients, like challenges where you analyze training request forms, where essentially if you're new to this course, like you're, when you start this course, you're essentially getting hired as an instructional designer on this fictitious retail team or this fictitious training team that serves a retail company. And you essentially take a project from beginning to end using like the textbook instructional design approach. So it's kind of like a mini master's program. So a lot of business acumen, a lot of stakeholder communication. And let me just show you some stuff here. So like, here's the data workbook. So as you're working through this first project in the course, right, like here's the training request form that you receive. As the learner, you evaluate it, right? You figure out what questions you still have. So like, right, what's the problem based off this training request form? Will learning solutions help solve it? What do we still need to know? From there, we prepare for a kickoff call, right? So we're gonna do all this preparation to identify a business goal, do some of these different types of analyses. And like, as we go, we also are gonna fill out these needs as we can identify them, the evidence for those needs, and then the type of gap that we're dealing with here, right? Is it knowledge gap, skill gap, environment gap? So people in this very first project in this whole course are going to go very deep into analysis and really put that detective hat on. And really, instead of just be treated like an order taker where your job is to design e-learning, you're really getting practice being a problem solver and diving into this organizational data, identifying solutions, and filling out these real world deliverables along the way, right? Like here's the needs assessment report. So this data workbook is like a messy place to do all of this initial like data collection and analysis. And then we create this needs assessment report, which will actually be seen by stakeholders. And then I have like these videos and challenges to guide people through it. So Sabrina Gonzalez has been a huge help here. We're kind of working in tandem to bring this to life. Again, November 1st is when we're bringing all of these new lessons live that we have so far. And from this initial analysis, we're diving into a design doc. So going really deep into learning science, instructional strategy. From there, we're doing our most advanced storyboard we've ever built before, influenced heavily by Gagne's 9 events. There's going to be virtual instructor-led training that's developed in here, evaluations that are getting conducted. It's essentially the most ambitious course I have ever built. Again, it's been years in the making, working on it to some degree throughout this entire time. It was so hard making sure that all of the data that comes up during analysis justifies all of the solutions that we're going to design. But I am so, so excited to bring this live and really help people see how doing this analysis and uncovering this data can help you design solutions that actually move the needle on the business goal and create real world impact. So again, can't wait to get this out there. Here's some stuff we've been working on with these like custom GPTs, like to let people simulate a kickoff call and having these stakeholder communications. You can see, right, we get some clear responses, some stuff we might need to dive into further when it comes to these metrics. Stage one, right, these interviews are just text-based, but we could definitely, I already have a lot of ideas about using some of that voice technology I just showed you so that people can practice actually having those conversations in real time with an AI-powered assistant to better prepare people for having these conversations on the job. So again, really excited to bring that live. It's essentially most of what I learned in my master's program, but packaged in this like self-paced on-demand format that is very practical and very corporate focused. So I hope that we can deliver on all of those promises. I have been a massive perfectionist about this course. So I'm really hoping it's gonna make an impact there. This other thing I've been working on is the instructional design skills assessment. So it's pretty cool. I've been doing a lot of the programming for it and wrote the questions. And then Sabrina Gonzalez helped a lot with the visuals here. I think it's looking pretty good. So we have all these different categories where we ask you questions. So around instructional design, e-learning development, AI and emerging tool readiness, like project quality, professional presence, analysis and evaluation. There's all these different categories where we have these different questions that let you self-assess. And then I wrote a lot of logic at the end to like grade you in each of these areas and show your biggest learning opportunities. So I'm hoping to roll this out within the next couple of weeks. I've had the questions all drafted and ready for a while now. We just need to bring this live and I think it's pretty much ready. So stay tuned for that. The other thing that was really technical that I was getting into and nerding out about quite a lot is MCPs, so Model Context Protocol. I'm trying to build some MCPs for my business, and essentially what these are is you define tools. Like this tool example right here is like get revenue forecast. And what you can do is you can make these tools available to whatever AI model that you want to use. So, you know, GPT-5, for example, if you're used to using ChatGPT, Claude Sonnet, if you're using the Claude model or the Anthropic models, you can give an AI model access to these tools, and these tools can have access to the software that you use on the job or to the data that you use to do your job. So where I started with my business is I'm building these tools to do some financial tasks for us. So like categorizing transactions and uploading them to our QuickBooks account, giving us revenue forecasts based on outstanding payment plans and subscriptions that people have across both of our businesses. And I want to show you what that looks like. I built it so that we can interact with it in Slack, and it just has test data right now, but I can ask this question to my Devlin OS bot, kind of like the AI tools. It says that it's thinking. And then it should be able to access this test data that I have in a database, use this tool that I've defined in code, which I've been working on using Claude Code quite heavily, which you can see right here. Like I have a lot of chats open. It can edit the code for you. I could do a whole video on this if you're interested in this geeky tech stuff. But it takes a couple of minutes, but it should tell me outstanding revenue in December per my different businesses based on subscriptions and payment plans. So here we go. So again, it's just test data right now, but yeah, Peck Academy, it combined the payment plans people are on in the test data. There's one active subscriber to our Devlin Peck Pro offer, so that's where that revenue is coming from. And there you have it. So this might have been a little bit confusing, but I'm essentially trying to build this AI-powered operating system for my entire business. And this is kind of like my nighttime hobby right now, because again, the Instructional Design Project Lab is my main responsibility. But stage one is essentially building these financial tools. So then when I'm talking to this AI tool in Slack, it has access to that stuff. It can give me that financial data that we need. It can create a report every week and send that to us on Slack. And then from there, we might be going into other areas of our business. So for like content creation, I can build a tool that can research the discussions that people are having in the community space around a specific topic. It can research my past content on that specific topic, maybe look at the comments and see if there are any trends or unanswered questions. It can draft an outline for what that video should include and run it by me. Once I approve it, it can turn that into Google Slides based on the approach that I use for these videos. So I hope, again, I'm saying a lot of words, but we can essentially build out these capabilities one task at a time and then offload a lot of our thinking power and, a lot of this busy work that we might have to do and offload it to these AI systems. Instead of just relying on like ChatGPT and having to explain it everything all the time, we can build this tool once and then we can put it into a system that can work together to serve us better and let our team focus on higher value tasks. So it feels very similar to doing a job task analysis as an instructional designer. So I'm seeing so many parallels here and it's really exciting. And I'm quite excited to create more content around this as I dive deeper into it. But essentially, right, when you do a job task analysis, you work with an employee and you're asking them, right, what tasks do you need to perform in order to do your job, right? One at a time, no task is too small to include, right? You might be doing this while you're observing that person do their job. And then you might start ranking things, right? Like which of these tasks are the most difficult? How difficult is it to do this task? What are the consequences if this task is done incorrectly? Which of these tasks do you have to do the most often? And then we can identify these like high priority tasks that historically might be a target for training, but now with what's possible with these AI tools and with MCP specifically, this new protocol, you can build these AI these tools that then you can hook up to any AI. So not just these commercial ones like ChatGPT or Claude Sonnet, you can also do it with companies' internal AI models. That's the cool part about building an MCP server, right? You define the tools and then any AI model can use it, even a company's internal proprietary model. So like stage three, right? After I build out these other tools to help serve our students, help serve our team, right, like Peck Academy, I can build out these tools to help give feedback on deliverables, to help analyze where people are struggling and give them personalized feedback via email or directly in the community space where they're already working, powered by AI. So I've got a lot of ideas. Again, I'm kind of just rambling about it a little bit right now, but stage two is building this infrastructure to support our current students, our current clients, and our team. And then stage three is building like a broader instructional design MCP with tools that can outline courses, write learning objectives, create good quiz questions, do all of that stuff. And then organizations can use that with their own proprietary AI models and none of their data comes to me. So that's the cool thing about MCPs. Right, they're just calling tools from my server, for example, and then their AI model is using that tool to get a better output than if it didn't have access to that tool. And anyone can create these MCPs, right? It's very low cost, essentially free. You can create one that only runs on your computer that you can use with Claude Desktop, for example. It never goes out on the web. No one else ever has access to it. So look into it if you're intrigued. It's a little techie, but it is like the new industry standard way to build tools that can be used by AI models. And another example, right? We use like an email automation software called Drip. With these MCPs, I could have it draft an email and instead of just giving me an email that I go and like copy and paste, for example, it can create a draft of it in the exact email automation software that I use. So I can go right into the tool I'm already using and see and make edits and that sort of thing. So that's part of this too. It doesn't just have access to the data we have. It can also use the tools that we use as long as we write the code to enable it to do that. And a lot of apps like Google, for example, they have an MCP that lets you access your Google Docs, your Google Sheets. It can take actions across the different Google services. So a lot of big companies already create MCPs too to give you more functionality with your AI tool out of the box. So again, I rambled a lot about that one, but it is very exciting to me just because what's possible. And I would like to eventually get to that point where I can create them an MCP that can do general instructional design tasks that my team can use as we develop courses, that orgs can use for their instructional design teams, and that I can even make available via like a web page, for example. So like freelancers and stuff like that can get access to those tools. So it's ambitions. It's on the horizon. It might take a while. But that's what I've been working on. The only other real prototype I have that I'm working on is kind of like some life prototyping, right? I'm prototyping some potential changes in my business. I've really appreciated having this month or so off of YouTube. I realized like doing that like weekly YouTube video campaign leading up to our last Peck Academy launch, that's what I always used to do, right? Like every week release an email about, you know, attracting people who want to become instructional designers in the case of that launch. And I realized it took a lot out of me, like just that pressure of every week knowing I have to do a YouTube video, you know, talking about a lot of the same concepts and stuff that I feel like I have been talking about for years. Like there is a part of me that is more excited by some of these projects I'm working on, and not having that weekly YouTube cadence lets me do a bit, like focus a bit deeper on these projects, do some deeper work. So I feel like that's been calling to me for a little while now, like taking it easier on YouTube, maybe doing one video a month, one video every couple of months. That idea still scares me just because this channel is a big part of how I built my business. I'm obviously not going to abandon you all or just stop posting completely, but I am really prototyping a cadence that works better for me, I'd say. And yeah, I was really eager to share something with you. That's where I'm like, I haven't done anything in a while. I don't know exactly how this video is going to come together, but I miss feeling connected to y'all. I want to show you what I've been working on, right? See where the excitement is. I still obviously appreciate your feedback. But yeah, I'm just trying a slower cadence. I'm not going to push so hard with like marketing and stuff like that. Like I'm just going to be a bit more chill, focus on doing some of this deep work that I know will create value for the industry and for you all in the future, and just trust the process. And maybe if y'all want to help me out with that, if you know people trying to become an instructional designer, let them know about Peck Academy. If y'all want to upskill with me, I still do these AI workshops every week inside of Devlin Peck Pro. And then I think we're going to have an opportunity around the end of November, around Black Friday, for people to get access to the Instructional Design Project Lab. If you want to go through that A to Z, basically like the biggest and most ambitious and hopefully best instructional design course I've ever built. That's been in the work for a long time. So you'll have an opportunity to join that. I'd love to see you in there. And then the only other thing is my wife and I are exploring other places to live, right? I've lived in Portland, Oregon for years now. Moving out of the States is sounding really appealing to us lately. We're looking at Amsterdam. So if you live there or you know anyone living there, I'd love to hear your perspective on that. It would be a very big change, right? It would take a lot of time and attention, but I'm hoping that it might lead to some better opportunities overall, some more peace of mind living in Europe. So that's another life prototype thing I've got going on where, I think we're ready to move on from the States and we're looking at next year, maybe moving to Amsterdam. So I'd love to hear your perspectives on that as well. Thank you for making it to the end of this video. Let me know which of these prototypes or projects you are most excited about. I'm open to any and all feedback, and I will see you in the next video.